my big brother Dave, okay, so the ready to cook?
Yeah. All right,
here we go. So, you know, as they say, I was really lucky to have David, as I've said from our previous remarks. But this is a shot here in the Christmas tree with little brother Cal, and Dave is the big honcho here, and he's into trains already. He's already in the trains, you know, at an early age. And these two are the parents that we shared with our sister, older sister Marion, and Dave and I. This is where we had all had horseshoes when we're associated with these people right here. The Reverend Heinrich and Mrs. Heinrich. What a combo between those two people. He was kind of a guy that could give a good sermon, and he'd say, "Oh, that's nice," and "Thank you," and so forth and so on. And then Mrs. Heinrich, Sister Heinrich, would be the person who would stay on the phone and would say, "Oh no, sister, I am so sorry to hear that. Oh, and tell me about your daughter now. Is that the third grandchild that she has now?" And so forth. And then we'd come by and we'd get a little tired of all this, you know, sweet talk. And then she'd get upset, she'd throw keys at us, you know, as we walked by. Because we were supposed to be quiet for when she was talking to Sister X, okay? All right, so that was, what a combo. And they would give you the shirt off their back. Here's Dave with Mom, and you see he's a good-looking guy. Now, this is a little clip. I included this especially for Greg, and I was hoping, and Linda, I was hoping that that we would have David and, you know, Crystal still be here, and also Greg and Glenn would be, appreciate this, and Jenny. But so this is Silver Lake, approximately ballpark 1948. Now this entity, this lake is now filled with cottages. But here's an excerpt from about 46. Now there's Dave. Now you notice no cottages at the other side, virtually no cottages. Cute little guy with an outboard motor. And he's a great guy, as far as boating, too. And now here's my introduction to sailing. Not that Dave was a big sailor at that point. He became a big sailor. But here's my introduction. There I am there. I'm there. And Dave has got a sailboat. And he goes in, and I was going to show him some swimming skills. Okay. So that's Dave there. And now, he was a bit of a leader. In other words, he was a reserved person a lot of times when you talk to him. But he was like, he would be at the head of the group sometimes if he had particular expertise, which he did here. Now this is in the, this is in the Catskills. My parents used to go up to the Catskills, and Dave was there with his older sister, Marion, 5 years his senior. And but he would lead the group, you know, as far as horseback riding. And he was a pretty aggressive guy. You know, he would be leading everybody, and you notice the other one, you just have passengers. Now here he is here. There he is right there, riding away. And here he is in the PS DuPont marching band. Okay, one of my heroes there, you know, actually a big brother now, big guy, big man on campus there. And here he is there with his uniform. And here he is in the Coast Guard Reserve. We were talking about his convoluted service to the country. He was first in the Coast Guard Reserve, and then later he went into the Army, and Army with his musical talents, and he was in the Army band, and that's where his main 3 years in Korea, in Asia, he was there mainly in Asia, and he brought back all these cameras, and he, Asodeska, Ohayo gozaimasu. I think I learned these different phrases from Dave in Japanese. This is in marching band. You'll get a little dizzy. Please excuse the photography, but this is in Westchester marching band. There he is there.
Which one is he?
There he is. I think he's right there. Trombone man. Yeah, I can't say. Now here's a guy that I remember. Now you know how impressionable you are now when someone's 10 years older than you, and he's your big brother. And you know, he, you know, this is one of our early boats with a 10 horsepower Johnson on there. And then we got into a 25 horsepower, and there's Dave, you know, one of my favorite shots, because I love the boat too. Not only love Dave, but I love the boat as well. And we let that boat go. Unfortunately, had we been, had the resources to salt it away, that craft would be worth a lot of money. A penny and captivator. Now this is my brother. This is what I remember. Now we had twin beds in this parsonage, and there between the twin beds he would put up a seat and a music stand, and then he would just, I mean, the scales he would put, and he would play Getting Sentimental Over You and Stardust, and I mean, I heard that so many times, but I really admired his tenacity. Now this is a little excerpt of Tommy. And I heard so many times. This is not Dave, but. You notice it's a mainline Ford, stripped down, 54, I believe. No extras, was a tight budget car. Taking a trip up to Silver Lake, and you know, he was, like I said, he would, you know, keep me under his wing. And this is Dave with his our older sister, 15 years my senior, 5 years the senior of David. But I understand he caught all those fish. There's a handsome guy, huh? I had to compete with that guy with the girls. It didn't work out too well, you know. Oh, when he met this lovely lady here now, you know, so this is when, you know, you can just see Vicky in ecstasy. I'm sure that was repeated many times. No, but, you know, they're just like the perfect couple. And David, oh, David, yes, could I help you with that? And, you know, so kind and caring. And I believe this is a quote now. Don't take this too serious, but I believe this is a correct quote. My purpose in life is to make David happy. Okay. There's a nice little quote. Correct? Just want to make him happy. What did I wish I had a wife like that? No, I'm just kidding. I do have a wife like that. This is when we got a little bit more progeny here, so forth going on. You know, this is one of our times up at Silver Lake. And I'm tucking in there, leaning in there, and there's our family as they grew, and Dave celebrating. Vicky, of course, would get a custom cake for David. It wouldn't be just a regular cake. You have to get a custom cake. All fits in with the parameters, you know. And okay, so Dave and I, just one little addendum to all of this, and I'll let you go in a few minutes. But okay, now, Dave and I were biology majors. Is Al Capitasto still here? Did he leave? Oh, Al, big Al. Okay, so Al, you know, we'd be up and we'd be talking. He's a geology guy. I'm early in my college career, and Dave and Al are more advanced. But we would have discussions, and I'd say, now, you know, I think that, you know, evolution makes a lot of sense, you know, because if you give, and I believe Al used to highlight this, if you the key is you have to have genetic variation, but the key is really the passage of time. If you were to have billions and billions of years, then these evolutionary processes and complexity of the human body could take place. But the key, as Al would say, as I recall, is the time factor. You have to have that time. So I believe that, and I, you know, I was a biology major, and I wanted to fit in, I wanted to be cool. And so, you know, I was really basically an agnostic, I used to describe myself. And not that I was happy with that, but I just was, okay, maybe, you know, creator, sounds kind of hokey. A couple thousand year old book, and you know, it didn't impress me that much. But but I used to ponder this, and I'm not going to try to get too erudite here, but if you have the law of conservation of energy and matter, okay, so you can't really create or destroy matter or energy, it changes states, and that's it. So that makes sense to me, but I'm gonna follow my train here. It's not a long train. Okay, so my question would be, if you had the Big Bang Theory, okay, now, scientifically, if you say you can't create or destroy matter and energy, then my question is, scientifically, where did the first energy and matter come from? You just told me, you just gave me a scientific principle, and you can't create or destroy matter. So where did the first energy and matter come from? To me, it is more scientific, if you will. If you go from the natural laws, which you just told me are constrained by the conservation of energy and matter, and if you were to go to a higher realm and say, well, that could be explained by going from the natural to the supernatural, to me that's more scientific, at least satisfying to look at it that way. So I've been thinking about this a long time, as you might imagine. And I'm not saying that evolution has not taken place. That's not the point. But I don't really think that it explains our existence. I really don't. So I don't know if you've been out, and this will be concluding now, it won't take you much longer, but Dr. Ben Alexander is a neurosurgeon, and he'll explain it. Now what I did with Dr. Alexander is I took excerpts of his presentations, because he had a very, very interesting, and you've heard many people with near-death experiences type of thing, right? But he got infected with a spontaneous E. coli meningitis, and they're not sure whether it was through travels or whatever, but he was stricken with this meningitis. When they tapped his spinal column, he actually had pus under pressure come out rather than cerebrospinal fluid, which was a very interesting thing, because this guy, he couldn't even get out of bed. He was in abject agony. He was in a coma for 1 week. This is a neurosurgeon. He's in a coma for 1 week. And he has an amazing account of what happened, okay? An amazing account. He was greeted by a beautiful woman, and he was really captivated by the beauty of this woman. He said, wow, this is like cool, you know, I got this beautiful woman here, and I really, wow, this is impressive. Okay, now I'm gonna make a connection with that in just a moment, just hold that thought. So, now, Dr. Alexander was adopted, and he never knew his biological parents. He never knew them. He went through life, and, you know, got through it, but he never knew, really knew, like, who the heck really were with my father and my mother. Well, it turns out that that's an excuse for the typo there, but I did this quickly, but it was his birth parents reached out to him in later years, okay? Excuse the typo. But his biological sister had died. His biological sister had died, okay? But as it turns out, this beautiful woman, he saw a picture of her, and this beautiful woman was actually his biological sister, a dead ringer, when he saw that picture of that beautiful woman when he was in this death experience or near-death experience. Here's Dr. Alexander, and I just took a few excerpts. I know you can't sit through all this. This is a long presentation. So I just collected three excerpts.
Because people have a way of looking at me up here and saying, well, he can't have been that sick. But the doctors who hear the story, and certainly my doctors to this day, have no idea how I came back. I have no idea how I came back, and yet I can tell you that there are some lessons in there that are beautiful lessons for all of us, because the power is there for all of us to awaken as eternal spiritual beings and come to realize much more what this is all about. I'm pretty much a child of the 50s, 60s, and 70s. And like many in this room who are of my generation, I grew up knowing that science is the pathway to truth. Now, I'm more of a scientist now than I've ever been. And I also realize that the science that I worshipped before my coma, and I promise you that pure materialist science, reductive materialism, that in a nutshell says, if you reduce everything down to electrons, protons, quarks, neutrons, photons, subatomic particles, build up the physics, chemistry, biology, the brain, and all of that, you can understand everything there is to understand about the workings of the universe. And the problem with that kind of thinking, the way it stands now, is that that science cannot offer up the first sentence to try and explain to you how the physical brain might give rise to consciousness. That is something I believed and accepted, hook, line, and sinker, because I worship that science. And what I'll tell you is that pure materialism in science, you know, just the physics, chemistry, biology, that is so woefully inadequate, even the first sentence to explain consciousness, that very same conventional science, which still holds the bully pulpit in this world, front page of the New York Times and all of that, in many ways is on the way out. This is all about a far deeper understanding of who we are and a great gift to science. This is all about science and spirituality converging. They're far more powerful together. And as much as one would like to think that science is a search for truth, you have to remember there's kind of an unwritten rule in science, and that is that you cannot invoke any kind of God, any kind of superior intelligence that might be at the core of all that's happening in this universe. And in fact, that's their blind spot. It's very much their blind spot. And that's one of the reasons why they've been struggling and wrestling for more than a century to try and explain the results of experiments in the most proven theory in all of the history of science, and that has to do with quantum mechanics. And I'll talk a bit more about why that's important in a little while. I know some people, when they hear quantum mechanics, they really just want to turn and go the other way. You don't have to know anything about the math or physics to understand what's going on here. All you have to realize is that the founding fathers of quantum mechanics, very brilliant physicists like Niels Bohr and Erwin Schrödinger, Werner Heisenberg, Paul Dirac, Louis de Broglie, even Albert Einstein, although he was dragged kicking and screaming to the end about the phenomenon of entanglement, which he called spooky action in the distance, really kind of haunted him. But I promise you, back in April 1955, he got a real glimpse of how it all works and what
he does.
And I will get into that. But the other thing to understand about that reductive materialist science that says the brain creates consciousness, it says it's all birth to death and nothing more. In fact, they will try and tell you that consciousness itself is a complete illusion. In other words, that it's just those subatomic particles, atoms, molecules in the brain, the cells in the brain, creating this illusion of consciousness, but no, they're just following natural laws. That kind of science is a faith-based religion that actually has almost nothing to support it. And as a neurosurgeon who spent more than 15 years at Harvard Medical School and really bought into the conventional model of brain creates consciousness, that's a pretty big admission about changing up my worldview.
So I just thought this was not a religious forum, you know, nor am I, as you can see, this is not religion. This is just an analysis of what possible variables are really at play, so many of which we really do not understand. I mean, we haven't even scratched the surface of this, and you know, in analyzing quantum mechanics and all of that, which is such a difficult area to understand. But I don't think it takes necessarily a spiritual person to at least intellectually admit that we do not have an entire explanation of by science of what this is all about, what this earthly existence is all about. And I submit that you really do have to, I think, at least intellectually accept the fact that we don't have all of that information, and indeed there will be those that will pretend to be Christians or have something, you know, and rather roll their eyes when you tell them, well, we're going to see David again. And they go, well, if that makes you feel good, more power to you. Basically, I don't buy it, but if that's so that makes you feel well, to me, that's they're certainly entitled to their opinion. But I don't believe their opinion is any more valid than any of the Christian concepts and so forth. Because if indeed there were an atonement that is, and you can argue or discuss how that all took place, but if indeed that took place, if there were an individual who in fact actually did come here in mortality and passed away and voluntarily passed away and did atone in a master plan for the sins of mankind, certainly intellectually at least, that possibility could exist. And then people say, well, it's just a, you know, kind of an account, you know, anecdotal account. And that may, that's no doubt true, but there are, it's an awful interesting concept to be thinking about. And so I just wanted to bring those comments. That's mine. Are we going to go to Ed Sullivan now?
Sure.
Okay.
Observations don't match, what do? We throw that model out. And following up on your comments, the very fact that we exist and that we're here and how that all of us made it through all those self-divisions and everything, it is something more than just science. Science problem is, if you can't measure it, it doesn't exist. Yet we see each other and we communicate. So one of the things that I thought about is one of the most enduring things is not our careers and the money that we make, but rather our memories of each other. And they will only last as long as somebody here to remember. So Vicki asked me to share things with you. I grew up in Newtown Square. Dave, as far as I knew, grew up in Wilmington. Our lives mirror each other in so many ways. We continued our interests, traveling up to Silver Lake, scuba diving in the lake, collecting Devonian fossils. And one of the first things that the school district gave me as a new teacher, ski and toboggan club, well, I had never been on a pair of skis. So I said to Dave, let's go up to the Poconos and see what snow skiing is all about. So Dave and I learned to ski in Pennsylvania in the Poconos, the Wilmington Ski Club, we went to Vermont. And then once in Vermont, one of those years, probably around 1965, there was no snow. So we went on up to the French Laurentians and Grey Rocks. So Dave and I skied many, many times all over. And then interest of Dave was scuba diving. So I got certified as a scuba diver. And we were down the Florida Keys, John Pennekamp State Park, El Sombrero, and the car that I took developed a hiss in the engine. So on our way back, we stopped in Miami, and the dealer said, you're out of state, so sit around, do something while we fix your car. And I was sitting in a 63 split window coupe Corvette, and I thought, I had always wanted a Corvette, and holding that steering wheel, when I get home, I'm going to order my Corvette, which I did. So my wife and I ran a lot of rallies and got Vicki and Dave. And on one rally, Dave's Corvette broke down. So how did we get Vicki and Dave home? Piled into that two-seater Corvette, four of us. And we went home. So and then my wife wanted an in-ground swimming pool, so we put a pool in. And then I quickly realized the people in the pool industry didn't understand the pool chemistry, and they had trouble communicating what they wanted to say, to sell you. So what happened? The teacher, I went into business for myself. And then I was doing very well, so I said to Dave and John Nagel and another teacher, and they started a business. So Dave and I had swimming pool businesses. Interaction there. Our marriages and our families interacted. And all the way to marriage career. So I'm going to end with a life of experiences and memories. Remember, life's fabric, day, a life well lived.
all right?
Yes.
Okay, we go. I just wanted to say, so I am Calvin's youngest son, Uncle Dave is my uncle. I wanted to say how how grateful I just had some of the best, happiest times of my childhood was. Was with Uncle Dave and Vicky when they would come with their daughters. I loved being with them. I loved the time that we had. We would do skits together. We'd make up dumb things together. Uncle Dave showed me how much he valued his brother. How much it meant to him to be close to his brother, his sister-in-law.
My mom.
How much he loved Vicky, his pop. How much he adored her. Gave me such a good example along with my parents of how to be a husband. And so I just am grateful so much for just the value he placed on the time that we could spend together and make sure that cousins were together. Our children, his children, my parents' children. Just grateful for all that time that he gave for us to be together. I just want to say that.
Thank you. Thanks.
My name is Glenn Bell, and I spent a lot of time in Uncle Dave's house growing up in the Heinrich house. Spent time from my age 12 to 25 growing up there. Uncle Dave taught me a lot about science. We would watch Sea Hunt together every Saturday night, and that's a show he loved to watch because of his diving and everything like that. He enjoyed doing that, so that is the only book I ever read in my entire life. I have the book at Silver Lake now and had my name written in it. Uncle Dave always liked to watch Jacques Cousteau, Underwater Adventures by that man. So we would watch that show together. He taught me a lot about biology. That was the only class I got straight A's in. All the other classes were just A's in. But he always, Calvin and Dave, always made me study, made sure I studied 3 hours a night. You pick one show you like to watch that night, and that's all you could watch. Then you went back to your room and studied. From 7 to 10, I picked a show, and I told my grandpa, I said, why do I have to study so much? He said, you got to get good grades. You got two uncles here that will teach you the right way to do things. And Uncle Dave was a guy that, like Calvin would say, a hard-working guy, taught you how to work well. When he had his Corvette, I used to wash that Corvette no matter what time of year it was. Go out with plastic gloves in the winter, wash it. You use the chamois to dry it, but after you dried it, you can't put your hand on the garden. He said the skin or the stuff in your hands would hurt the paint. I don't understand why, but that's right. But he was a great young man. He did a lot in his life. I have a book he gave me, really two books. At my birthday, he gave me in 1959. I still have the book. It's called The Sea Around Us. And it's very interesting. Now, I have this boat at home. My uncle would drive me crazy with it. I built this boat about this long. It's a Chris-Craft boat, and it's not done yet. So my uncle would ask me, Landy, have you finished the boat yet? I said, no, Cal. I mean, Dave, it's, the directions are big as tables, like three tables, three pages. I said, I haven't got around to it. I'm scared to put the shaft in there to make the hole to go in there. If I screw it up, then I'm in trouble. He said, well, look, just bring it to me. Well, I never got a chance to bring it to him. But someday I'll complete it for him. He was a great guy. Taught me how to water ski at age 13, because I had to learn how to swim first. And then at 13, then he took me once to Wick Ski Shop up in North Wilmington. He said, you're going to buy a pair of snow skis because we're going skiing. I said, oh, you're kidding me. He said, no, you're going to learn. So we went up to Wick Ski Shop. My skis are actually tall up to this on my hand. I said, my goodness, look how big they are. He said, we're going to go to Doe Mountain. He taught me how to snow ski, taught me how to water ski. It's great. He was a great uncle. I'll miss him dearly.
Army, Army, the Army, the coconut. Thank you.